Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome our Prime Minister, John Key, and his wife, Brona.
Where the sand greets the tide, where the oceans collide, that's where I long to be, in a great country. For a line in the sand, now it's time to make a stand. Time to walk proud and free, in a great country. Our hopes and our dreams are growing with our pride. We stand all as one on the wild mountainside. And when we raise our spirit high, we will not be denied.
The 8th of November, 2008. What a night. With the support of 1,053,398 New Zealanders, we changed the government, we changed the outlook for New Zealand. You see, delegates, those voters believed in a better New Zealand. They were tired of being told what they could or could not do, what their kids could have as a Friday treat from the tuck shop, and whether they could choose their own light bulb. Yes, they yearn for a more ambitious future, and with them, you, the party faithful, made that change possible. You put up the placards, you sold the raffle tickets, you knocked on the doors, and you posted the pamphlets. And who will forget the stunning wins? We're celebrating them here this weekend. 9 new electorates with some fantastic victories, 16 new MPs in our caucus, our biggest party vote ever. So we did the hard yards and we reaped the rewards. And I've got to say what a privilege it is to be your Prime Minister. I'm thankful to each and every one of you who brought us here. Let me express my particular special thanks to Judy Kirk, our departing President. Judy, you stuck by the National Party through the rough and the smooth. You built this new party, the new structure it needed to serve a new generation. You gave us 7 great years of presidency and you led us to our historic victory. And you did it with grace and with humour and with unshakable belief in what we could achieve. And in doing so, you helped secure the brighter future this country deserves. Delegates, today we thank you, Judy Kirk, forever the party vote president. And we're joined in welcoming our new president, Peter Goodfellow. The National Party is delighted to have elected you, and Peter, we wish you the very best in the years ahead. I want to say a special thank you to my deputy, Bill English. I'm grateful to have him as Deputy Prime Minister. He's wise, he's dedicated, he's a compassionate New Zealander, and he's absolutely thrilled to know it will forever be called the Bill English Cycleway. Going through his hometown of Dipton. There's always life after politics, eh? You gotta think to the future. I want to say a special thank you to Stephen Joyce. What a stellar campaign you ran, Stephen. And I say thank you to the rest of the Cabinet, the caucus, the board members, the old and the new, the electorate chairs, the electorate agents, the office holders, the volunteers, and most of all, you, the members. So it's great to be here in Christchurch, isn't it? It is. It's a wonderful city where I spent my school years, where I lived with my two sisters and where my mum raised me with all that she had. The city where I fell in love with Brona. The city where I bought my first National Party rosette. Where I went to university, where I got my first job, and where I formed my belief that within each of us lies the capacity to make our own lives better. That with hard work and with personal responsibility, with big dreams, we can all make more of ourselves. That is the belief which has always set the National Party apart. We know that government actions can never replace the determination and drive that lies within each individual. Nor can the government take the place of our families and our communities. But a good government can provide the foundation for greater opportunities. That's why the National Party leads New Zealand's government today. Because New Zealanders heard our message of opportunity and they voted for it in droves. They knew that our party would lead a country which rewards rather than discourages effort. They knew that our government would not try to involve itself in decisions best made by New Zealanders in their own homes and their communities. They knew that we would remain resolutely focused on securing the brighter future this country deserves. Let me take a moment to reflect on all that we have achieved in our first 9 months in office. We started by forming a stable, inclusive government with our confidence and supply partners. We turned first to our friends in the ACT Party. From the moment the election result was known, they pledged their support, and ever since, the relationship has grown and developed. And I want to thank Rodney Hyde. From the moment the election result was known on Saturday night, November the 8th, there was never any doubt there would be a National-led government. In Peter Dunn, we found a man of honour and integrity. And none of us should forget that it was Peter Dunn and the United Future Party that declared that they wanted to form a national government even before the election result was held. And with your support and goodwill, we traversed a path many in the media believed wasn't possible, and formed an alliance with the Māori Party. Set against a backdrop of respect and ambition, we captured the imagination of Māori and Pākehā alike, and we formed a relationship with Peter Sharples and Tariana Turia. And it's right to applaud, because in doing so, we broke new ground for our party and this nation. So we build on our confidence and supply relationships every day, through everything we achieve together and everything we disagree on. We know that the respect and mana born of these relationships enhances our ability to govern for all New Zealanders, and it ensures that the National Party will be capable of leading a government for many years to come. I am pleased that we've made so much of the cards the voters dealt us. After all, this is a country built on the ideas of partnership and inclusiveness. It is only fitting that those values are reflected in the makeup of our government. I'm also very proud of the new policies our government has delivered on. When I travel around New Zealand, Kiwis tell me their stories about how much these policies mean for them. Like the single mum who thanked me for the government's first 100 days decision to publicly fund a 12-month course of Herceptin. She started 2008 with her life in tatters. She'd been diagnosed with HER2-type breast cancer. She had a mastectomy and 30 lymph nodes removed. She was unable to work because of the cancer and was having to fork out for huge Herceptin payments every 3 weeks. Thanks to this government, thanks to your government, she no longer has to worry about making those personal payments, and I think you should be very proud of that. Well, the mother of a 5-year-old girl with autism, she wrote of the monumental and traumatic campaign she had to secure special needs funding for her daughter. She thanked the national government for our foresight in boosting special education funding by $51 million so that so many other mums and dads would be spared what she had suffered. Or the woman who wrote in to thank us for the student loan voluntary repayment bonus. She had $20,000 left on her loan and relished the opportunity to pay it off faster so she could get a mortgage and buy a house. We made a real difference to her life, and we've made a real difference to the hundreds of New Zealanders who've signed up for voluntary bonding, whether they're nurses or doctors or midwives. Those are New Zealanders that will be working in our communities, making a difference to fellow New Zealanders, and they are the sort of policies that we are all very proud of. So, ladies and gentlemen, delegates, thousands of New Zealanders have a good story to tell about this national government. Like the 1.5 million working Kiwis made better off by our April 1 tax cuts. The 500,000 super annuitants who had their super locked in at 66% of the after-tax wage. The hundreds of families who have been given a helping hand by the restart package. The thousands of people in the Coromandel and the thousands of Kiwi holiday goers who are cheering our decision to fast-track the rebuild of the Kaupo Bridge. The parents who, thanks to our national standards in literacy and numeracy, will get a plain English report next year telling them exactly how their primary school child is doing. If you want to make a difference to the outlook for New Zealand and the lives of everyday New Zealanders, it's that policy that's going to deliver it. It's the 400,000 people of Counties Manukau who started to see the first of the 300 extra police working their streets. Not to mention the good citizens of Christchurch who are no doubt looking forward to the government's looming ability to crush the cars of boy racers. And the thousands of families who will feel safer in their homes and in their streets thanks to our tougher bail and sentencing laws. Ladies and gentlemen, these were the policies we campaigned on. Despite the fiercest economic storm, we have delivered. Today we focus on the task that lies ahead. There can be no doubt we have come to office at a difficult time. The world is in recession and Kiwis are losing their jobs. Our businesses are finding it tough. There are no surpluses left in the Crown accounts. But we do not shirk from these challenges, nor do we resolve from the ambitions we campaigned on. A more prosperous economy is at the heart of our vision. And yes, we know that strengthening this economy won't be easy, but we take this task on gladly because it will secure the brighter future we wish for our country. New Zealanders, there is light at the end of the recessionary tunnel. The New Zealand economy is forecast to start growing again later this year. Unemployment will take a bit longer to turn around. We will be doing all that we can to ensure that our return to growth continues as strongly as possible for as long as possible. We have, as Bill talked about yesterday, an economic plan for achieving this. And it consists of six main policy drivers. I want you to go away and remember these six drivers because they are vital to securing a brighter future for New Zealand. They are regulatory reform, investment in infrastructure, as we heard the team talking about this morning, better public services, as you've heard us talking about a great deal, education and skills, innovation and business assistance, and a world-class tax system. The depth of the recession means that we are experiencing high unemployment for the first time in a decade. The good news is that our unemployment rate shouldn't get as high as the United States or the United Kingdom or Australia. But that is small comfort to the everyday New Zealanders who may find themselves without a job. We feel for those Kiwis. They are our sons and daughters, our brothers and sisters, our cousins and nephews. They are some of the delegates in the room here today, and I've been talking to them about that issue. But the task of the government is not to pretend it can create a job for every Kiwi who loses one. That will require the effort of all New Zealanders. Our country's real jobs engine is made up of the smart ideas of our small businesses, the output of our farmers, the rising fortunes of our exporters, the strengths of our communities, and the foresight and competitiveness of our industry. The government's responsibility is to bolster their efforts and to do our bit to ensure that Kiwis who lose their jobs have the opportunities they need to get back into work. That means creating a business environment which gives firms the confidence they need to invest and to create new jobs. It means offering an extra helping hand to families hit especially hard by the financial blow of redundancy. And it means connecting job seekers with new job opportunities, upskilling them and keeping them connected to the workforce. Our government, your government, is doing all of these things. We are backing unemployed Kiwis and we are confident of their future prospects. But even so, I remain concerned for one particular group of people who may be permanently damaged by the lack of job opportunities over the next few months. I'm concerned for our young people. Those aged 18 to 24 are the fastest growing age group on the unemployment benefit, representing a third of all of those who receive it. The number of young people who wanted a job but couldn't get one has more than quadrupled in the past year, leaping from less than 4,000 in June 2008 to nearly 17,000 by June this year. My concern is that for a young person starting out in their working life, a long period of unemployment could be very damaging. These are New Zealanders who may have very limited experience of the routine and rewards of regular work. Without the opportunity to gain that experience, their development and their aspirations may be permanently weakened. Some may be tempted to fill unoccupied hours with petty crime, drinking and drug use, or other activities that sell them way short of their potential. My fears are backed up by research. Young people are disproportionately affected by long periods spent on the benefit. We simply can't afford to leave our young languishing on the benefit. If we do, we risk diminishing the potential of an entire generation of New Zealanders. I won't accept it, and you shouldn't accept it either. So So today I'm announcing a youth opportunities package that is designed to strengthen the ladder of opportunity for young people during the period of heightened unemployment. These policies will provide young, unemployed people with an expanded range of opportunities to better themselves, whether through work, training or education. The Youth Opportunities Package reflects my belief that it's up to individual young people to make the most of the opportunities they face. We owe them a chance and they owe us their best efforts in return. These policies are also driven by my conviction that all New Zealanders have a stake in the plight of the next generation. I'm yet to visit a Kiwi community, business or family that is not concerned about the prospects of those who will fill our shoes tomorrow. So these policies are drawn on that passion. They require commitment not just the government, but of all those who have a stake in securing a brighter future for New Zealand. Because we in the National Party know it's not just government who can solve all of our problems. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to be realistic. These policies will not create a job for every young person who finds themselves unemployed over the next 18 months. But the initiatives I'm announcing today will provide a new rung on the ladder of opportunity, a rung that could fire up a young person's motivation and aspiration while increasing their chances of getting and maintaining a job in the future. Let me touch on some of the highlights of the government's Youth Opportunities Package. Many of these policies are about encouraging business and community groups to make job opportunities available to young people. We know that while the economy turns itself around, many employers will be reluctant to hire young people who are yet to develop basic work skills. A small business owner may have enough work to justify a new entry-level worker, but may lack the will needed to hire and train a young person for the job. A community group may have a great project in mind, but may not have considered using a team of young people to get that project off the ground. In both cases, good ideas could end up in the too hard basket for the next couple of years. So today I'm announcing that the government will provide specific funding to help firms and communities take these ideas out of the too hard basket and into the realm of possibility. The first policy is Job Ops. Job Ops is the government's policy for backing businesses that create jobs for young people. We want young people who have limited work experience to get a chance to prove themselves and to get a taste for what they might be good at. To make this happen, the government will ask businesses to provide lowly skilled young people with a job for a minimum of 6 months. We'll ask businesses to work with these young people to build work skills, foster confidence, and where appropriate, provide them with references for future work. In recognition of these efforts, we will provide funding to the employer. This funding will be spread across two payments, totaling $5,000 over the 6 months. It will be money well spent, because I, for one, would rather invest your taxes in jobs for our young people than in unemployment benefits. So here's a challenge for all you community-minded business people out there. Ask yourself, are you ready to give back to the young people on whom our future depends? If you are, this policy is for you. The government has put aside $20 million in funding for up to 4,000 job ops over the next 18 months. And I want to see it cranking up as soon as possible. We'll be taking expressions of interest from Monday. So let's hear from you all. Of course, businesses aren't the only ones who can play a role in creating opportunities for young people. Local authorities, mayors, iwi and community groups are also ready to step up. So I'm announcing Community Max. Community maxes the government's policy for connecting young people to the positive work that goes on within our communities. I know that up and down the country there are community organisations with good development ideas. I'm asking those groups to come to the government with local community projects that could be worked on by our young people. It might be time to renovate the local marae or kahanga reo, or to smarten up local parks and reserves, or to get rid of graffiti and tagging. The government will fund young people to work on these projects. We will help fund their training, and we will fund supervisors to help as well, because we want our young people helping our communities, and we want our communities helping them. I expect huge demand for Community Max. So the government has set aside $40 million to back this policy until December 2010. And I expect many of these projects will pick up significant numbers of Māori and Pacific youth who are overrepresented in the youth unemployment statistics. Te Puna Kōkiri and the Ministry of Pacific Island Affairs will work with Māori and Pacific organisations to develop project proposals. And I fully expect Tariana Turia, Peter Sharples and Georgina Tehuhu to get out there and promote this policy to the Māori and Pacific Island communities they serve so well. Because I know that they, like me, are impatient to see our young people fulfilling their true promise and their potential. The development of the National Cycleway. The Bill English Cycleway. It's a project that provides a great opportunity. So today I'm announcing an additional $5.3 million for the cycleway that we set aside to encourage those developing great rides to take on and train young people. It won't all be in dipdom, but it could allow up to 500 young people to take part in developing the cycleway. We're also going to put a greater emphasis on youth in the industry partnership program, with 600 new work and training opportunities. The young people targeted will get access to industry-specific, on-the-job training and a chance to build a career for themselves. I imagine that industries supporting the Rugby World Cup could be particularly interested in using this program to upskill their workers over the next 18 months. And while they're at it, maybe they could upskill the All Blacks over the next 18 months as well. Patience is a virtue, they tell me. But anyway. My fellow delegates, for many young people in this recession, work experience and on-the-job training, like I've outlined, will be the leg up that's needed. It will provide them with a proven work record, basic job skills, and a sense of routine and discipline and dignity that comes from paid employment. After all, those are the values that this party and this country believes in. But some young people may be better served by more time spent in more formal education and training. Put simply, there are currently too many young New Zealanders who aren't engaged by any of these options. They might be turned off school or feel trapped without the basic skills needed for an apprenticeship or formal education. We have to do better for these young people, particularly in light of the forecast rise in unemployment. Because if we fail to keep them engaged in education, their chances of finding a job will be lower than ever. Well, this national government won't accept that. That's why we are devising new options to make education and training more relevant and accessible for a greater range of young people. Let me outline some of the ways we will do this today. From January next year, we will jumpstart stage one of National's Youth Guarantee Policy. This policy will help 16 and 17-year-olds who are no longer engaged at school get a second chance at education. Stage one will allow up to 2,000 16 and 17-year-olds to undertake vocational training at a polytech, wānanga, or a private training establishment. They'll pay no fees for this training. The government has allocated a total of $53 million to allocate 2,000 places for this purpose in both 2010 and 2011. Because we know that traditional secondary school doesn't work for everyone. We're doing something about it. Students on the youth guarantee might, for example, join a mechanical maintenance course, working on cars and completing literacy credits at the same time. Or they might do a pre-trades course that uses workshops and hands-on learning to prepare them for an apprenticeship. Whatever form it takes, the youth guarantee promises to engage young people that might otherwise be left behind by our education system. Because our national government believes in them, and we believe in their futures. In addition to the youth guarantee, we are opening up the options in our secondary schools, because we know that some kids will get more out of ripping an engine apart than studying Macbeth. Not necessarily me, but some students. We're already considering business proposals for trade academies, which will give young people the ability to gain practical, hands-on vocational skills while still at school. I also want to expand the number of service academies throughout the country. Service academies are military-focused programs based in schools where students may otherwise be less likely to gain a qualification. The programs are designed for Year 12 and 13 students who want to pursue a career with the New Zealand Defence Force. They include a minimum requirement that students sit and attain Level 1 NCEA Maths and English. I want to see more of this kind of training available for school students. So I'm pleased to announce that the government has set aside $2.6 million in funding for that purpose. I'm also confident that the discipline and values this service training provides will make a difference for hundreds of our young Kiwis. I'm also committed to enhancing the education and training opportunities for those aged 18 to 24. We've already started working with the New Zealand Defence Force and the New Zealand Police to devise new training opportunities. Ministers are busy developing gap year options, and we will make further announcements about these in the future. But all some young people need is a short burst of this type of training, just enough to give them the encouragement they need to push on into further education or employment. That's exactly how the Limited Services Volunteer Program works, and for those of you in Christchurch, you'll probably know a fair bit about it because it runs out of the Burnham Military Camp and it uses a military-type program to instill self-discipline, confidence, and motivation. It's worth applauding because it's got a great track record, and I want to see more young people being able to take part in it. So today I'm announcing that from January 2010, the government will invest $19 million to create an additional LSV program in Auckland and another one in the Lower North Island. It's going to allow a total of 2,500 additional young people to take part in LSV over 2010 and 2011. It's an investment in them, and frankly, it's an investment in our future. Of course, some of the best vocational education and training for young people is provided by our polytechs and institutes of technology. The forecast increase in unemployment may well put more pressure on them over the next few months. The national government makes no apology for expecting polytechs to do more with less during this recession. Even so, we will work with polytechs so that as enrolment pressures build, they are able to ensure adequate education opportunities for our young people. That will require innovation from them, and it may require some flexibility from us. So today I'm demonstrating the government's commitment by announcing that later this year, the Tertiary Education Commission will allocate $8 million of further funding for the polytechs. We expect this extra funding to be targeted at those with the highest needs and those aged under 24, with them expected to be the particular focus. The funding is additional to the significant investment we already make in our wananga, polytechs, private training establishments, modern apprenticeships, coordinators and universities, all of whom provide important educational opportunities for our young people. I am a huge believer in the liberating power of education, and our investment priorities reflects that belief. Finally, we expect the high unemployment rate may well be paired with a reduction in the number of jobs available for tertiary students this summer. It's hard on them and it's hard on their families. We will respond to this in two ways. First, by beefing up the number of jobs available through student job search. We'll do this by referring all suitable work and income vacancies to student job search. Work and Income will also work with employers, local councils, mayors, iwi and community groups to identify vacancies for students. Second, we will put a new summer scholarship scheme into action during the summer break. This was an idea that came out of the Job Summit and is based on a partnership with New Zealand's university's vice-chancellors. The scheme will provide up to 1,600 summer research scholarships worth $5,000 each. The scholarship funding will go directly to the university students involved. The government is putting $4 million towards this initiative, and we are being matched dollar for dollar by the universities. We think it's a wonderful example of what's possible when the government works with others to develop solutions. Ladies and gentlemen, the policies I've announced today are going to make a big difference for our young people. They will create up to 16,900 additional youth opportunities over the next 2 years. That's right, a total of 16,900 additional opportunities for New Zealand's young people. The total cost of this package is $152 million. And it's an investment I'm proud to be making. Some of this funding was allocated in the 2009 budget, while the rest will be appropriated from the between budget contingency. So I can reassure you this budget, this package will in no way add to the government's debt levels. My fellow delegates, the policies I have announced today will add significant rungs to the ladder of opportunity for our young people. They send a clear message to all young New Zealanders. This country backs you. We will invest in you and we will invest in your future. We have big aspirations for you and we want you to have big aspirations for yourself. The manner of your climb is up to you. It may be through work, it may be through education, it might be out in the community. We simply ask that you strive to make the very best of yourself. We will judge you not by where you are today, but what you have decided to become. My fellow delegates, today's policy announcement is not just about New Zealand's young people. Today I'm asking all of us to set our sights a little higher. Each of us has a choice to make. Will we sit back and complain about the increasing number of jobless youth? Will we stand up and do our bit? What can we do to give our young people the opportunities they deserve? After all, the future success of our country, the future success of each of us, relies on unlocking the potential of the new generation. I'm proud to lead a government that is making this a greater country for the next generation to inherit. I'm proud to be leading a government that believes in the power of individuals to take control of their own lives. I'm proud to be leading a government that gives every Kiwi greater opportunities to get ahead. Those are the aspirations this party was founded on. Those are the aspirations this government was elected to deliver, and those are the aspirations I am proud to represent. Thank you very much for a wonderful conference, and thank you for supporting the National Party.